Hello and welcome to Insight, a show where we have courageous conversations about social justice and the issues affecting the citizens of the region of Peel and beyond. I'm one of your hosts, David Barnwell, and we're here to discuss a very delicate subject today. According to the Ontario Women's Directorate 2013 report, women who are aged in the college and university range are 15 to 25% more likely to experience some form of sexual violence while on their college or university campus. Our topic for this episode is sexual abuse on university campuses. We're joined by three of our Insight hosts, Ranjit, Dave, and Ann Chow, and a very special guest, Carolyn Dickinson, to share her authentic story and give us some insight into this topic. Welcome, everyone.
Thank you very much for joining us today, Carolyn. Before we start, I want to share with you the challenge that putting this show together has actually been. Because when we started doing the research, and it was one of the young people that had suggested we do the show, and we reached out to a number of universities, all our local universities, we went as far as Windsor, and we really struggled with getting staff and administration to actually come and join us. So thank you for coming today to make this show possible. We do have a message, and we're hoping that we'll be able to share all the messages that we bring to the show and identify how important it is that this dialogue doesn't stop just because people are tired of the Gomeshi case or because they're tired of listening to, you know, the stories that truly need to be told. And we need you to share with us today your story that's brought you here.
Thank you for having me tonight. You know, it's interesting because you go through university, you go through college, and you don't realize the kind of things you're going to encounter. And I certainly didn't imagine or expect that I would encounter being harassed or being accosted at college and university. And unfortunately, I did encounter it. There was two specific episodes that occurred for me. One of them was going to my car in very late at night. The parking lots at the time that I was in university were not very well lit, and they're quite far away from the actual buildings. And there was one night where there was a gentleman, well, I'll say gentleman, but there was a man hiding behind some cars. And if I had not seen him pop up and decide to take off back to the building, you know, life could have been very different for me at that point. Not that I haven't had other experiences, but, you know, definitely that would have been quite violent because I'd heard shortly afterwards that he did catch someone else. So I escaped that individual situation, but I did go back and I did try to contact security. That was a big challenge for me, and try to get someone to take me to my car. Well, they told me it was a 45-minute wait, and this was already 10 o'clock at night. I need to go home. So for me to get that support, I had to go find somebody I knew in the campus, a couple of guy friends, which took me another 15 minutes to find, mm-hmm. to actually walk me back to my car. Mm-hmm. And that in itself was pretty scary. And in the second situation, I was in a classroom, and you know, you innocently sit beside someone not thinking anything, you know, male, female, I'll talk to everybody. And you start to get to know your classmates. Well, little did I know that this particular person that chose to sit beside me had already basically gone after the teacher and several other girls in my class. But I didn't know that, and nobody told me that. It got to the point where he then started offering to walk me to my car, and it didn't feel right, so I'd always have somebody else to do that. It got to the point where it became inappropriate in our meetings where he would mention things, and this is a married man. This isn't even a single man. And it got to the point where I finally said, you know, you need to just focus on school because that's where I'm focused. He then contacted, because I also had a part-time job, found out what my phone number was at work, where I worked, because I said I worked for the city at the time, looked me up and started calling me at work and started harassing me. And I did go to the campus and I did tell them what was happening. And they said, well, that's very hard to prove. It's very hard to support you in this. So it got to a point that the only way that I could protect myself, right? And I'd already talked to the teacher and she said, I've tried as well. I can't get him out of my class. The school wasn't even supporting the professor. And there was other girls in the class who had already dealt with this. So I decided to, in this situation, take it into my own hands. And I contacted my ex-boyfriend, who was 6'4" and built like a brick house. and basically said, I need your help. And the only way to get this person from stopping, he was following me at work. He said he was sitting outside waiting for me. So, you know, by the time you would actually call the cops and they would come, he's gone. So, and I don't have his address. I don't have his phone number. I didn't take it. It wasn't like I was interested.
Yeah.
You know, so I really was kind of between a hard and a rock and a hard place and really feeling like I had nowhere to turn and no support in keeping myself safe. And who knows what this person would have done. So I literally had to ask my ex-boyfriend to threaten him. And that was the thing that stopped him. And it was funny afterwards, the professor and a couple other girls in the class came and thanked me because he left the class after that.
It's sad to think that that's what it takes, you know, in order for us to feel safe, you know, and to be able to,
to sort of retaliate with violence.
Right.
Or at least the threat of violence.
And that's not something we support. We're not saying, okay, go out and do that.
No, not at all.
But if the universities aren't supporting us and aren't able to keep us safe and don't necessarily have the tools or the strategies in order to safeguard us, then what recourse do we have?
Yeah.
Right? Except to do what we feel in our guts is the right thing to do. And I know as a parent, I would be struggling with that. You know, if my daughter came home and told me that this is what was happening, you know what? I would be there. 5 foot nothing and I would be there.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah. So, and that's an issue. So, and we've had, you know, a human rights case right now that's going before the courts, before the tribunal, because of the university not taking appropriate or sufficient action in order to safeguard this particular student. And the challenges that we've had is getting that support from the university to say, you know what, these are the things we're doing. We actually want to talk about them.
Mm-hmm.
We actually want to talk about the wonderful things that are now coming out of the university to ensure the safety of our youth. Because that's all we need to know, right?
Absolutely.
Is what are you doing and how transparent is it? Can we go online and check it out? Because if the youth were going to university now, one of the things they need to do is check online and see what's out there and be, you know, be aware of what those policies, processes, safeguards are. And when you were at university, the fact that this has happened to you and
on more than one occasion.
Exactly. And the harassment and continuing and you having to take responsibility yourself. It's quite shocking.
It is.
So how did it affect you, Carolyn? How did all of this affect you long term?
Well, you know, as strong a person as I am, and that wasn't my first experience in that. It's happened in my life before, you know, being date raped. But, you know, what happens is that you start to question yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You start to question, did I do something? It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter how strong you are, your education, your background. It's irrelevant. When you experience something like this, you go through a process. It's no different from someone passing away. We go through a process in that healing and that mourning process. Well, when you've gone through something like this, there's a process you deal with. And that comes around with guilt. That comes around with going, what did I do? Could I have done something differently? Did I attract this? And absolutely not, you did not.
Mm-hmm.
However, you still question that because society still questions that, right? Back and forth in both circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, because, you know, you wonder, well, what if I'd handled it differently? Your brain goes through this entire emotional process. And, you know, it's really important to get the support that you need. And you do have to go through this. It's almost like, as I said, it's mourning. There's a process to it. There's anger. There's resentment. There's guilt. There's all these things that you need to go through. The problem that happens, I find, and I've seen, because I've also done some counseling in this area with people, is that basically you don't ask for the help because you're afraid of being criticized. You're afraid of being judged. And when you don't ask for the help or you try to push it underneath and push it away and ignore it, it manifests even stronger and harder. And it comes back up in your life multiple times. It's not something that's ever gonna go away, but it is important to allow yourself to feel the things you need to feel and go through those steps to be able to get to a point where you're feeling good about yourself again.
Mm-hmm. But when the university isn't offering that, it's how difficult is it for you to do it?
And almost impossible. Unless you source out your own counseling, your own support. And even then, when you're walking around, I think, a college or a university, and you're looking for that support, and you go into a counseling department, what do you say to them?
Yeah.
Because they're like, well, we need to call the police, we need to do a report. And maybe you're not ready to do that yet. unfortunately, you know, what I experienced, and I'm sure things have changed so much lately with counselors and stuff, but in my situation, they didn't know how to handle it. So basically it came back on me again to figure it out on my own. Again, things have changed so substantially since 20 years ago, and I'm sure there still needs to be multiple improvement, but it's really trying to figure out, and I say this to anyone, if you're going through this and you don't feel comfortable in the school, there's so many other sources you can go to. I know it doesn't seem like, you know, are they going to really believe me? The thing is, you need to heal. At the end of the day, it's not about the person who abused you, it's about you. It's about you being able to forgive yourself, to love yourself again, to love the situation, and find that help wherever you have to go. Whether it's a friend, whether it's a family member, whether it's a counselor, there's a lot of free resources out there and available, which I'm sure you guys will eventually talk about, but there's so many things that you can do and go to. And I highly, highly, you know, I beg of people, if you're in the circumstance, please go for the help, because it does affect every aspect of your life later on. It's not something that ever goes away. It is a part of who I am, but it's also allowed me to have the compassion, the understanding, to be able to support others, to learn from that experience and take away from it to the point where I can actually love it. And that's a very difficult place to get to, and it took me, I couldn't say that till about 6 years ago, to be honest with you. And I'm 46 years old, right?
That was 14 years of healing.
14 years of all over the place, ignoring it, trying to heal, trying to find the right resources, trying to get the support. And you know what, life has to go on. It's not like you can stop. And in some cases, some people will. I'm very fortunate that there was something inside of me that drove me. Not everybody has that. But there was something inside of me that kept me going, driving me to keep going no matter what, in all my circumstances and all aspects of my life, until they eventually became blessings for me.
Now, if you know, hearing the statistics earlier, we know it's exponentially higher, the likelihood of females being abused on campus. Why do you think the universities are so reluctant to address this if the numbers are so staggeringly high?
Well, in my opinion, because then they have to admit there's a problem.
Yeah.
And no corporation, company, and forgive me for saying this, but most people don't want to admit there's a problem. They want to kind of handle it from behind. Because the problem with it is that once you admit that there's a problem, not only will you have the people that are going to support you, like you guys going, thank you for taking the effort, you're going to have the people that are going to come up and go, well, you should have done this earlier. Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you know about this? You know, my daughter. And so there's the two sides to it, right? They want to do something, I think. I believe that, because any experience I've had with anybody would never want to see somebody hurt.
Yeah.
But the other side of it is then they're looking at, well, what are the ramifications for me admitting that this is a problem and how do I handle this?
And the expense that goes with it.
Absolutely.
Because when we're looking at revitalizing or refiguring or reorganizing any large institution, then that acknowledgement goes with responsibility, and that
Absolutely.
Responsibility has a money figure that goes with it. And the students have to be involved, the staff have to be involved, even the parents or community need to be involved. And maybe Bill 132 is going to make that difference. You know, maybe now that it's mandated, then maybe it will make that difference to hold the universities or colleges accountable for what they need to implement in order to bring that change. And we won't know that because the Royal Assents only just happened in March of this year. So maybe change will happen. But I think what stuns me is that it takes a lifetime to get over an act that could be that quick.
Absolutely.
And for that lifetime, it's not just change your personality, it's changed who you are and who you've become.
Absolutely.
Right? So when we take it lightly and we think that, you know what, so what, it's okay, it's not.
No, it's not.
Right? It's not. So
it's
I think
it's not fine, it's not okay, it's not no big deal, it's a huge deal.
It is. And it does change you for life, as you said.
It does.
Right?
It completely changes you, it completely affects every aspect of your life. And so I tell people, it doesn't ever go away, but if you can learn to respect it, love it, and understand it.
How do you love it?
You know, when I was told this 10 years, maybe 12 years ago, that that's what I needed to come to, and that one day I would say that. I said, absolutely not, never. How could I ever say that I would love this? And I think the way you look at it is, it's not really loving that, but it's loving yourself, mm-hmm. all of you. And that is part of you. So it's important to love you as a person and yourself as a person as a whole. And to be loved as a whole is to love every situation, positive and negative, that's ever happened in your life. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And when it's not an easy road, I'm not gonna sugarcoat it. It's not easy. And I have moments where stuff pops. I have a 7-year-old and a 4-year-old, mm-hmm. and they're both girls. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a part of me that is hypersensitive to this, but it's also created awareness. So I probably know more than most parents, unless they've been through it. Mm-hmm. Those that haven't don't have the same sort of consciousness I have about where my children go, who they play with, mm-hmm. what house I'm going to let them go to, due to my own experiences.
So you're protecting your kids and making sure that they don't have the same experience as you, or do the best that you can in order to protect them the best you know how.
The best
now.
Way you can.
Right.
Right? Because you can't. Like, I mean, there's no, I can't be there all the time. I can't always be there. I can arm them with as much intelligence around it as I can. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Be there at a young age, talk to them about the importance right. of asking for help, talking to me about everything.
So what's your key message to our audience today?
No matter who you are, no matter what you've been done, you need to ask for help. You cannot overcome, mm-hmm. love yourself again without help. And you know what? If you have tried one person and it doesn't work, don't give up, try someone else. Think of it as, you know, if you went out and tried a car and you didn't like it, I know that sounds, you know, very like superficial to say that, but if you didn't like the car, would you buy it? No, you'd buy another one. You'd mm-hmm. go look for another one. Mm-hmm. The same thing with support systems. If it's not working for you, find someone else. Don't give up on yourself.
Thank you so much for
Thank
joining
you.
Us today. So we'll be coming straight back after Play Matters, so stay with us and we'll be with you.
And welcome to the Play Matters segment. I'm Rachel.
I'm Christina.
And we're going to be talking about sexual abuse and how to make some masks.
So children who are sexually abused may present one of or many of the following characteristics: isolation, embarrassment, shame, distance, withdrawal, potential troubles in school. They may have nightmares, exhibit signs of depression, discomfort when being touched, or you may see regressive and or aggressive behaviors. Sexual abuse can be embarrassing and a traumatizing experience. Children may feel uncomfortable and vulnerable around adults and reluctant to express their feelings. As a parent, it is important to recognize potential behavioral signs and encourage your child to talk about the experience in a safe place and calming manner. One of the ways you can start the conversation is to participate in an activity with your child, such as making a mask. Making a mask is a great therapeutic tool to reduce that sense of vulnerability and encourage children to express themselves.
So we are going to show you how to make some masks, just like these ones down over here. So first thing you're going to need is some plates. And what you're going to do is we're going to try to cut the plates in half. One of the halves will be for your child, and then the others will be for yourself. So I'm just going to try to cut half here. I'm not the best cutter, probably as you can see here. And we're going to go right down the middle, just like so. So that way you have two halves. And we have two halves as well like this. We want to try to make them as even as possible so that they're one on top of the other. So that way it actually balances both you and your child's face. And then what you're going to do is with the two halves, we have it here, we're going to want to make holes so that way you can kind of see through it with the eyes like this. So I'm just going to have Christine actually hold it up against her face.
Cool. Okay.
Okay. And what you want to do is you're going to ask her to put where the where her eyes are, and you're just going to put a little dot. Like so. And then what you're going to do is you're going to cut around. Now, this may seem fairly easy, but what you want to do is you want to try to make it as close to the shape of the eye as possible.
So you have more room to kind of decorate and kind of play around with everything that we have here on the table.
Like this.
And it looks like that.
So hopefully you can see it looking like this. Ta-da!
So then the next thing you can do is probably thinking, how am I going to wear the mask? Well, there's multiple ways of doing it, but today we're going to show you how to use a string. So basically what you do, just grab some yarn you can find around your house or even at the dollar store. And basically you do here is you have to punch two holes, again with a pencil or with a marker, and basically you're going to tie, we tied around what, 3 knots around this?
Yeah.
Around the string to make sure. And then just to make sure, you grab the string around like this, put it on my head, wrap it around, and I see I need this much string art for it to stay properly on my head. So then I'm going to take it back, loop it through, just like this. Sometimes it can be a little bit difficult, but that's okay. If you don't want to use string, you can actually use, what's it called, popsicle sticks, or even just put it on your face, like regular.
Exactly. So for the benefit of the time, we are only going to tie one knot here, so that way you can actually just kind of see what it looks like. So hopefully, at the end, once Christina's done, you should be able to kind of put the mask on your face, and it should hold like so.
Like that.
So what we're going to do now is this is kind of the time where you can decorate with your child, have some fun. So we have some stickers here. We've got some kind of like 3D stickers.
Glitter glue, feathers, markers, you name it. I'm going to go for it.
A little obsessed with butterflies, I'm not going to lie. So I'm just going to put a few here, just like this. Obviously, I cannot rip.
Again, be creative as you can and don't disturb the creativity of your child. It's really important, especially during this time. It's time for them to like kind of get their creativity and express their feelings on what they've been feeling and holding inside. Like
exactly.
This.
So this is my mask. Hopefully you guys like it.
Hold on. I want to
so
do my butterfly.
Like
hold
this.
On. Hold on. I'm going to put it like, yeah. No, that's not going to work for me. It's okay. Hold on. I got it right there. Ha-ha. Just like that. Just simple little thing. Of course, a little rush, but that's okay.
Like this. So, what we want you guys to get out of the mask is that, parents, this may be a frightening conversation at first to have for both you and your child. So it's important to remember to be patient, listen, avoid judgment, and reassure your child it is always okay to come and talk to you. Remember that when wearing a mask, it allows children to feel shielded and safe to talk about the abuse. With a mask on, children may feel as though their thoughts and fears are not being judged and they are able to process what has happened in a controlled and safe way. So thank you for joining us. Hopefully you guys enjoy the mask. And that is all for today.
Bye guys.
Welcome back to Insight, a courageous conversation today on sexual assault and harassment on university campuses. Thank you very much for joining us, Jessica. We're really proud to have you here today and share some of your experiences in terms of the university campus and what you're doing now to protect and safeguard our youth.
Mm-hmm. So for the past 3 years, I've been on the sexual violence policy committee at York University, and this I think has been done for many years prior to me even becoming involved, of a need for a policy on campus or procedures that are clear-cut on campus so survivors of sexual violence come forward and are able to know what they're going to be going through and how they're going to be handled within what situations they come forward through. So the policy committee is established with support service workers, administrators, student voices. And I think the most thing that I'm very proud of is we were able to get the most marginalized student voices on campus to be part of that. Because I think when we talk about sexual violence and we start addressing these issues, you don't necessarily see faces of people that are not white that are the mainstream of these issues that happen, right? Mm-hmm. So having these voices and how people experience sexual violence in different ways and the intersectionality that they go through when dealing with sexual violence, I think, is one of the most things that I'm proud to have, especially at York University.
Perfect. So it sounds as though you have survivors that are on the committee that have come forward?
So people don't necessarily need to identify that they are survivors on the committee, but people that are put forth by the community service groups are able to identify with the issue or have some knowledge of the issue to be able to contribute to it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so when you do have an incident, and we won't mention names, but we do have an incident where one of the students is actually filing a claim against the university for not being able to provide the support that was necessary. Where do you think the gaps were, and are there gaps still in your eyes based on the work that you've done within the committee?
I think when it comes to sexual violence, it's going to be ever evolving, and there's always issues that are going to come through, right? And everything needs to be dealt with a case-by-case basis, because what I'm going to say or what someone else is going to say is going to be different. And the support and care that I need or if someone wants to go to the police that I may necessarily not want to go to the police, all those options need to be available, and that's the role of a sexual assault policy committee, and procedures like that need to be in place so you're catering to what an individual specifically needs for their support and care.
Mm-hmm. Do you see after your group has come up with the policies, do you see them being posted online so that students know what to do before they select their university and they know that they are safeguarded and protected?
I know that our sexual policy is online, but I don't necessarily think when people are going to go to university that they have the knowledge of what sexual violence is or where it happens or why it happens, right? Because mm-hmm. what people think sexual violence is, it's a predator in a bush that comes after you. But 86% of sexual assaults are someone you know, yeah. right? And so I guess having these stranger danger myths, which do occur, but like the media seems to hyperbolize this, right? And make it seem like that's the only issue. But we have to understand that it's not only about sexual violence and predators. It's about educating the community to know that when you experience sexual violence, to know that the support resources are there for you, and to know that this is all based on patriarchy and sexism. And that's what we need to abolish in order to even be able to address sexual violence mm-hmm. on campus.
Mm-hmm. But there could be tips, you know, mm-hmm. that students are aware of in terms of even statistics of the impact of alcohol and drugs on being violated and what that looks like, so that at least people can begin to think very carefully about leaving their alcohol or their drink exposed and moving away from it and understanding that somebody has access to it and they could do whatever they want with it in terms of putting drugs in there or in terms of impacting them to begin to make those wrong decisions, as it were, right?
I think tips are important, but you need to be careful when you're giving tips as a university, right? Mm-hmm. So I've done research on sexual violence, and I found one university I'm not gonna name, and one of their tips was to fight back. And how problematic is that to tell someone that you could have stopped yourself from being sexually assaulted if you were to fight back? Or saying things like, you know,
it's sort of like re-victimizing the victim in that case when you're telling them to fight back. The reason why they became a victim is because they did nothing about it.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
That they stood and allowed it to happen.
Or you gender the safety tips, right? So
yes.
I remember reading something where it was like, leave a male jacket in your car, or make sure you get a male to walk you and things like that. And you know what? Sometimes I've even done that, right? I've had male friends walk me when I'm uncomfortable or mm-hmm. don't feel safe. But that's, again, reiterating that women don't belong on a campus, because what you're telling them is the more you stay home or the more you make it seem like there's a man that's near you or protecting you, that's the only way you are strong or you can be valued.
Right.
So yeah. It's like it's very important to not only share tips, but also give tips that, like, I remember there was one tip where it's like, be aware of your surroundings. Obviously, I'm aware of my surroundings. So mm-hmm. you're saying if I experienced sexual violence, I wasn't aware of my surroundings. Is that what mm-hmm. you're trying to say?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But if you are able to say, you know, make sure that if you are drinking mm-hmm. to have your drink right with you and not to leave it, you know, sort of unguarded.
Of course.
You know, tips that a lot of young people that have stayed home that are naive, and I have to say there are a lot of us that are, is to bring that to their attention. So that when they are thinking of going to university, maybe this would be a site that we would encourage them to go to prepare and make sure that they're ready for the world out there and exposed to it, right?
But I think those are conversations that maybe needed to have at happen home. Earlier, or even at school when you're in high school, when you're at university fairs, if the universities are promoting, yes, we do have this sexual assault yeah. policy in place, I think that would get students thinking about it a lot sooner. It'll get more students protected. I'm not sure if you're able to do that or what protocol would be mm-hmm. for that. But
mm-hmm. So tell us about Bill 132. What does that look like? So and how has that impacted your work?
Mm-hmm. So at York, we've been doing work on the sexual assault policy for a while. But Bill 132, and it's something that I've wanted for many years doing work in this field, is kind of accountability for institutions. But it mm-hmm. deals with sexual violence, harassment, and generally the entire spectrum of sexual violence, not only within university and colleges, but within tenant rights and other like statutory limits as well. And specifically, one of the things that it expects from universities and colleges is a standard written policy and procedures that are outlined for students, which is so important, right? Because when all that information came out, I think maybe a year ago, 9 universities had sexual assault policies. So now this is kind of accountability for institutions to be able to respond not only to, yes, we just have a piece of paper that we establish with rules, but actually, you know, incorporating students, because that's part of 132, mm-hmm. to make sure you get student input so that you have input when you're establishing these things and not just creating it from your, you know, your own research that you read about without actually acknowledging what the community is offering you. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've talked a lot about student-on-student, sort of the appearance of student-on-student violence or sexual violence. What does Bill C-32, 132, have for faculty and student in terms of that scenario?
Or even faculty to faculty.
Or faculty to faculty, yeah.
So Bill 132 originally in the first reading focused on sexual assault policies just for students, right? And when there was a reading where people were able to talk about the bylaws, I went as well. And we shared that, you know, like sexual violence on a university campus or a college campus is not just within students. It can be within staff, it can be within faculty. So we need to be able to establish a policy that's for everyone, where everyone can receive the care and support they need and have protocols and procedures. And our policy already is catered to everyone. But it's also understanding the relationships with, if you're a grad student, if you work for the university, if you're just an undergrad student, if you're a volunteer on campus, how do you access these resources? And these are important things that we need to talk about. And you can't talk about that without consulting faculty, without consulting, you know, students on campus, without consulting staff, because all these people have different roles on campus, but sexual violence impacts everyone in the same way. So how do you cater to people and make sure that their rights are maintained while even providing them with support or resources?
Or even talking about the onlookers. So, you know, it's not just now, it's not just about the two people, but it's people that are engaged in observing what's happening and doing nothing about it, you know, which becomes a part of the policies and the processes as well. And that's a critical component, right?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up because there's a bystander program we're creating, and I know that I'm not sure if any other schools are creating, but this is something that was started in the States, but there is never really a model that could fit your campus, right? When you talk about the States, they have a culture or certain things there that they relate to. But at York, we decided to create our own with the university in consultation with students about, you know, when you see someone or you see a friend and you think they're in danger, maybe just go ask them, right? Don't intervene because people have the right to their bodies and to do whatever they wish to do. But like ask someone if you're okay, or different ways of distracting people when they're in uncomfortable situations, right? Like, I know we've all been in situations where we kind of just look at our friends like, help me, right? Or get this person away from me. But talking about bystander culture and why it's important for us as a community to get involved, because sexual violence doesn't just impact the person, it impacts the community.
Yeah.
Right. And that community is really broad. So again, it's not just your friends, it's the whole of the university for staff too. I mean, it reflects on the university, the credibility, the integrity in so many different ways. And it could be that, you know, if I was aware of a situation, I'd be saying to my kids, I'm sorry, but you're not going to that university. And it's interesting because when we go into one of the articles on the in the Toronto Star a while back was talking about sexual abuse and how actually mentioned one university having a high number of young people that had come out and identified that they had been victims of sexual assault. And we were actually having a dialogue about that and saying, well, what does that translate into? Because from some of us, our opinion was that the more people feel comfortable within that university, the more the university is doing to make young people feel that this is a safe place, the more willing they are to actually come out and identify that they have been abused or assaulted. So the high numbers don't necessarily mean that it's a bad place. It could mean that they're doing a great job, right? Mm-hmm. And how do we get to know that? Like, how do we distinguish with, you know, how many incidents have happened? And do we relate that to, is it a safe university or not a safe university?
I completely agree with you. Like, when you were saying that, I was nodding along because I, like, for people to come forward and report an instance of sexual violence, you need to be comfortable and you need to feel safe, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think for everyone that doesn't come forward, there are many people that actually don't come forward at all, right? The statistics that we have are not real statistics. because not many people report to the police. I don't think, I don't even remember the statistic of how many people do. Mm-hmm. And if you have to go to campus security, you need to acknowledge of what people are going to these security services or what people are going to these police officers that feel comfortable, right? Because there's a lot of issues with security on campus where racialized students don't even feel comfortable or are targeted, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how do you go towards someone that targets you on campus to then be re-victimized or being told that, you know, you're hypersexualized or it may be your fault, right? Mm-hmm. And I think when statistics are put in the media, and we at York, we send out security bulletins every time there's been a sexual assault and the person hasn't been apprehended, right? So if the person is still out there at large. And a lot of people say, like, you know, like, you're the, they say the rape school. I'm sorry for saying the word rape, but that's just what they say, right? And it's unfortunate because if a school is being transparent, that's what we need everyone to be. Because if someone goes through sexual violence, you need to know that. Because if we just hide it, you're continuing to reproduce this norm that sexual violence only happens in scary places or that it doesn't happen on campus at all. So I would say the more reports an institution has, the more they're actually letting students know of how to actually report, right? What we should be looking into is why people aren't reporting and how you can better help and care and support those students that aren't reporting and what are the reasons behind that, right? Because if you don't feel comfortable going towards the police or security, then there should be a measure where, you know what, you can just miss that exam or you can get, you know, counseling without having to go that extra step that you're not comfortable doing.
Right.
Now, I want to take the other side of that argument. We can look at those high numbers at certain institutions being indicative of the students feeling comfortable and more reporting happen, or we can just look at the fact that 3 out of 10 incidents go reported and that number actually being indicative of more abuse happening on campus. What is there to be said about that?
For me, sexual violence happens anywhere, right?
Yeah.
And I think to talk about and have a bill on sexual violence to happen on university and colleges is very privileged, right? Because I'm privileged, I go to an institution. But what happens to the person that doesn't go to university or college, and that's a child in an abusive home or, you know, in abusive institutions that doesn't have that voice? So when we talk about college and university, we're talking about access that students have to be able to talk about these issues, right? But for people that don't have that, that's why this is such a hot topic of university and colleges, because we have the ability to have a voice and to speak out about that. But what happens to childhood survivors? What happens to people that, you know, live in poverty and experience this every day of their lives? What happens to people that experience this from their employers but can't leave their jobs or can't report it because of the issues that will happen if they do report it, right? And it's a great first step to, you know, tackle university and college sexual violence. Mm-hmm. But let's talk about people that aren't that privileged or don't have access to those systems. Mm-hmm. And how do they get their voice heard? Because the only avenues they have, they don't pay for resource support centers where they can go in and say, this happened to me, I need help. Mm-hmm. Where do they go? To the police?
So what's your key message today? What do you want our audience to hear from this?
I think that people should be looking at sexual violence as a broad spectrum that not only affects people the same way, but actually affects people differently, right? And looking at how we can help people and meet them where they are, not only through reporting or police or other things, but take sexual violence back into support and care. And how do you actually give support and care to people? And why do people not go or talk about these issues? So breaking the stigma of sexual violence, but also understanding who we're leaving behind when we talk about this from just a university and college perspective.
I agree, and I think because our focus was to talk about it from a university and college perspective, I think it's critical that we put it out there that the universities and colleges need to be an open, transparent institution that engages young people. Right.
Exactly, and it's not just having one student voice. Right. It's having multiple student voices who have multiple different experiences.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
So we'll be going right now to our next break, our artists, and we'll be back. So stay tuned.
little girls. Sugar and spice and everything nice, little girls. The manifestation of the sincere smile of God, little girls. The beauty and perfection of things done right and what fairies must sound like when they play. Innocently laughing and dreaming about growing into their wings to one day fly away and no longer be little girls. But does such a big God with such a brilliant smile hear when little girls cry? Dirty pink frills and hearts so afraid, do fairies sprinkle magic dust and help undeveloped wings fly away when little girls are stolen in the middle of the night, sold for 60,000 rupees for $3,000 for some bread and the dreams of a white picket fence? Fenceless villages at wit's end search for little girls. Mothers wailing in structures falling apart like her world, now found stuck in the mud along with white ribbons and no sign of her remembrance of God's grin, for he has vanished, along with 9 months of labor intensive and love, along with the commitment that though little girls are less deserving of life, they are deserving of a loving father and mother, at least, and at least aunts and uncles know where she is, but greed makes everyone quiet. And so dry tears like hardback crocodiles roll saucily down fat cheeks still indented with the bread that was baked from the heat, the red, hot, searing pain from in between the legs of little girls. Legs that kick and lungs that scream. Tears as black and biting like the raging August monsoon fall to never fall again. And again, and again, and again rips, and again beatings, and again 250,000 little girls are broken. Forever they will be stunted, yet no longer, for her immaturity has been stolen and replaced with soiled bedsheets, eyeshadows on lips and sexy high heels, her precious impression dignity sold for 50 cents a death, too young for the mantra, no condoms, no sex, because tired men pay for a claim on her worn out virginity. Where is God when she cries? He no longer has a smile, for that little girl has died, and in her place is a hardened slave to the carnality of the world. Round and round and round it goes, but when it stops, little girls don't know, no longer even cares, because all of her emotions and strengths are gloried on survival. How do you expect Asha, Shoba, Bharat, and Avanti, 9, 11, and 13, to understand that she is now to die of HIV? And how does she, once filled with sugar and spice, dreams that included a king to her queen and children not bastardized by circumstance, contemplate the will to survive when her broken body is the entertainment's capital, when she is a beauty of Mumbai?
Welcome back to Insight, our show on courageous conversations. And today's conversation is about sexual assault and harassment on university campuses. And we have with us our guest now, Deirdre. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
It's fantastic to have you here and share your experience. And I know that you've been a volunteer with the Rape Crisis Center for the longest time. And I know that you are a student at university right now. So you have this wealth of experience, and I'd like you to share with us what you do and how you help and guide and support young people that have been survivors of sexual assault and harassment.
All right. At the Toronto Rape Crisis Center, we have a bunch of different ways to support survivors. We offer one-to-one face-to-face counseling, which is very challenging for survivors of violence to find. And we have a small staff team, so our capacity is also small. And it's not unusual for there to be waiting lists for counseling at various agencies across the city.
Yeah. Really?
It's not unusual for folks to wait sometimes as much as 6 months to get in for counseling at a local organization like the TRCC or others throughout the city. Yeah, because there just isn't enough capacity.
See, and that's what happens in Peel too, is that we really lack the resources to be able to support a lot of young people that might otherwise come forward. So the young people that you deal with, do you identify young people that are coming to you from university abuse or assault?
Well, when I said we have a couple of different ways, I think one of the most common ways that people actually come to the center is as volunteers, right? Mm-hmm. In fact,
they volunteer first.
They
and,
volunteer.
And that's sort of when the story comes out.
Yeah, right? So me personally, I went there 15 years ago now, when I was in my 20s, and I was looking for a way to give back to community, to do some work and help out. And it took maybe a year of working there, being supported, you know, learning the language, talk around and debunk rape culture, mm-hmm. before I could actually say, yeah, I'm a survivor too.
Yeah.
And it was the kind of thing where, because I'm a survivor of incest, it wasn't the kind of thing that I had ever spoken about or been easy holding as a part of myself, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. But even going there to do work and to help others gave me the confidence, the chance to heal, the language, the vocabulary to talk about what was going on for me and to be able to claim and own that,
yeah.
and then really begin to heal. Yeah,
it's interesting because I was talking to Hope 24/7, which exists here in Peel, and I was told that students from Sheridan College are actually referred to Hope 24/7.
Oh.
So, and I haven't been able to do the research that I needed to do, but to understand that when young people come to the Rape Crisis Center, do they identify that they're actually coming from the university, or as you were suggesting, that, you know, do they come and just volunteer and then gradually you understand that they have been, you know, survivors of situations that come from the university? How does that work? Any ideas?
It's a great question.
Mm.
It takes sometimes as much as a year or longer for folks to seek counseling sometimes. Mm. So that there are ways that people can start to get support without necessarily having to come in for face-to-face counseling.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, we do have a 24-hour crisis line that's staffed by trained volunteers, right? So that people can call and get some support if they're having a hard time sleeping or
wow.
if they've had a flashback or something. And so sometimes we don't know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it takes so long, because there's so much stigma, okay?
Yeah.
Because there's so many barriers around sexual assault and reporting sexual assault, the very act of going to a place like the TRCC or calling a crisis line is a massive act of courage. We don't make it easy for folks, you know,
yeah.
as a society,
mm-hmm.
and that's really, really hard. That's one of the things that the TRCC tries to do, is try to address rape culture, rape myths. For example, the idea that women shouldn't walk out on the street late at night by themselves. Well, if men can walk on the street late at night, obviously the streets are not unsafe.
Yeah.
Right? So why can women not walk on the street late at night? Because something is happening out there that is making women, and also trans people, unsafe on the streets at night. We
yeah.
need to talk about the fact that, what is it, 95% of all sexual assault is committed by men.
Mm.
We need to start talking about how, as a society, we're
that's
raising our sons.
Sorry,
yes.
that's actually something that I'd like to address as one of the myths, and I'm sorry to say that, but 95% of what we know.
Yes,
because
absolutely.
I, you know, in our previous season, we talked about sexual abuse against men.
Yes.
And the fact that the reporting rates are so much lower than that of women. So if we have 30% of sexual abuse reported that are committed to by women and
mm-hmm.
trans, and only 30% go reported, we have 1/3 of that, 30%.
Yeah.
of abuse towards men that is actually reported.
Yeah.
So we're looking at a number that 95% of abuse is committed by men, but do we actually know that?
So my data is
yeah.
coming from the TRCC in terms
yeah.
of, because the TRCC does also serve men, we do provide
yeah.
counseling to men. And it's more like the body of knowledge that we've had
yes.
over time, yeah? So that, obviously, men and boys are also victims of sexual assault. And here's what becomes really, really challenging. When we're talking about dealing with patriarchy and sexism in society,
mm-hmm.
it is important for us to know and acknowledge that it has constraints on men too.
Yeah.
Yeah? That men are every bit as messed up by patriarchal thinking
yep.
as women are, as trans folks are, right? And so like you said, it's deeply systemic. And what we do know is really just the tip of the iceberg.
Yeah.
Right? Can you imagine if there were a world in which it were possible to have frank conversations with young kids, with youth in high school, about what sexism and patriarchy means in our lives, means in terms of trying to become a whole person, means in terms of trying to live well with others. Mm-hmm. If those conversations started really, really young, you'd get to a point where it wouldn't be possible to do a study, and it's 20-something years old, yeah, in the U.S., where they surveyed college and university age men, and 2 out of 3 said, yes, if I could get away with raping someone, I would. If
wow.
we start
disturbing.
Wow.
If we were to start having conversations with our sons, I have an almost 18-year-old. Mm-hmm. When do we begin saying, actually, it's not okay to rape someone? Like, when do we say to someone, look, if you ask somebody for her number and she says, I don't want to talk to you, leave her alone. Just the other day, I was talking to a guy on the bus, and he said some really messed up stuff, and I was like, okay, you have a nice weekend, I'm gonna go. And you know, he started yelling at me down the length of the bus as I walked away. And when I got off the bus, he starts yelling at me down the sidewalk and across the street as I'm going, what kind of mindset is it that a man thinks that just because a woman doesn't want to speak to him in a public place, he has the right to treat her like that, right? It's that deep, it's that ethereal and that concrete at the same time. And we just need to we need to stop pretending like if we can't do something. We can absolutely do something. We can have this conversation at home, at mm-hmm. school, at work, at the bar, at the cafe, at the park. We can talk about this
yeah.
because it's affecting all of us, and it's not gonna get better. You see this Gian Gomeshi thing? Those things are not gonna change until we get up and say, hey, we're not gonna accept this anymore. We've constructed our society like this.
Yeah.
And we have to take responsibility for change bit by bit by bit.
And I think within different cultures, mm. you know, so take a South Asian culture,
ooh.
Or the African culture, it's even harder.
Yes, it is.
You know, so if we're going to start that conversation
yeah.
mainstream, you know, within the schools, within the homes, then that conversation needs to be in a place where people feel comfortable and in a place where people
yeah.
feel safe, right?
Yeah.
So even starting that conversation in school is a challenge because not every teacher or every student is going to be comfortable talking about it.
Absolutely.
So how do we prepare institutions, parents, children to have those courageous conversations,
yeah.
right? How do we begin that? How do we begin that dialogue? And I think it starts with us.
Yeah.
Right? It starts with us. It's taking that responsibility and saying, yeah, you know what? It's a tough conversation, but we need to have
it. We need to have it.
And I think for that reason, the challenge putting the show together and getting courageous people like yourself to come forward, but to have institutions actually wanting to come forward. And I have to say today, I was really blessed because Sheridan College, when I contacted them, and I only contacted them today, mm. I had contacted 6 months ago all of the other universities in our areas, but Sheridan, when I contacted them today, did say, we'd love to be on the show, and we're going
great.
To really try and get somebody out there today.
That's
As it
amazing.
Happens, they weren't able to facilitate it, but at least
and
I know.
You know, to their credit, that was only within a few hours. They
Absolutely.
Only had about 3 hours, and they could not facilitate, but they were
Absolutely.
Very willing to.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, and that's why that conversation comes. But what I loved was what they called Bill 132,
yes.
and that is, it's never okay. You know,
yeah.
so it's never okay, an action plan to stop sexual violence and harassment.
That's
so
right.
if we're looking at an action plan, if we're looking at Bill 132, it talks to all the critical things, all the important things that we need to do. In
yes.
terms of involving students, in terms of involving staff, in terms of having service providers
That's
there,
right.
and being able to move it forward.
Mm-hmm.
And the work that you're doing at the Rape Crisis Center, for example, is being able to provide that support on an ongoing basis,
yes.
because that support may be needed years down the road.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yes.
So they may be survivors from the university time, but now we're adults and we have children and we may need to go back and get the support to actually heal.
That's precisely it. And that journey can take so long that you just never know what stage a woman is in her journey or a person is when they come forward. One of the things that the TRCC does like about Bill 132 right now is that it does look at a range of sexualized violence.
Right.
Yeah. So that the idea of it never being okay is that it starts with comments. It starts with intimidation or bullying tactics in sexualized ways. Yeah. And it goes right up to that sexual assault, that rape. So that there's a whole range of behaviors that the bill is hoping to address. Mm-hmm. And that range of behaviors, those things go toward creating a climate, a lack of safety and security for students, right? When smaller things, mm-hmm. things happen and they're not addressed and mm-hmm. they're just kind of under the radar and no one's paying attention. Mm-hmm. We're pretending that's not really a problem. We're pretending that it's okay. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So that's what we like about the bill is that it's making it very clear that this range of behaviors needs to be addressed and mm-hmm. there is no incident too small mm-hmm. to take into account.
I agree.
I think that's really important because oftentimes people, males, females, don't realize that walking down the street, somebody's whistling at me. I don't find that flattering. I find it insulting. You're treating me like you would treat a dog. Please don't whistle at me. And it's addressing those behaviors right from the get-go because that whistle could then turn into a greater incident.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so targeting it now is what's key. And I think the province of Ontario is doing a really good job of that now. I've noticed all around, I've seen it in Humber now, I've seen it at restaurants, in the bathrooms, they have these promotional materials now in the stalls that say, you know, if you're not helping her, you're helping him. Mm-hmm. And I think that's going a long way to address the bystander effect we were talking about mm-hmm. a little bit earlier. I'm not sure what TRCC's comments are or thoughts are on the province of Ontario stepping in and now starting this campaign.
Well, for us, it is finally a systemic way of addressing things, yeah? And again, it's the tip of the iceberg in terms of what it will be able to address and what it will be able to accomplish, yes? Mm-hmm. But at least it's looking at things broadly and systemically, and that allows the possibility for real change.
And we've got to be the ones that make sure that that change is real change and hold the universities accountable.
We need to
hold them. So your key message, please.
My key message is that we as citizens have the power to change things, that we need to keep our leaders accountable, our institutions accountable. We need to start breaking the silence around sexualized violence in the spaces that we occupy.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And now over to David.
Thank you, Ranjit.
It's very obvious from the information that's been shared with us today that there is most certainly a stigma associated with rape and sexual abuse or sexual violence. It's so important for us to realize that when we meet a victim, we can't use comments or questions of, well, what did you do to stop it? It just re-victimizes the individual and is most likely contributing to the fact that people are afraid to come forward and admit that they have been a victim of sexual violence. Don't be afraid to come forward. Find your support groups. And as always, keep yourself safe. On behalf of the hosts here on Insight, we hope you found this one very informative. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook, Towards Social Justice, and follow us on Twitter, @TowardsSJ. Keep having those courageous conversations.